Ladies and gentlemen, welcome to the National Celebration of Reading hosted by the Barbara Bush Foundation for Family Literacy. To open this evening's program, please welcome to the stage acclaimed actress and singer Linda Carter, accompanied by Grammy-winning songwriter John Jarvis.
Thank you. Ooh, thank you very much. I'm going to do a song that I wanted to do this for Barbara. She has a few sons, and it's a song that I wrote for my own son a few years ago. And I took the lyric to John Jarvis, who is a two-time Grammy-winning songwriter and a very dear friend of mine. We've worked together for a while. And he put some music to it that really touched my heart. So Barbara, this is for you. Well, I know that face by heart, and every time we part, you change just a little. With the sunlight in your eyes, your easy grin as you say goodbye, then you change just a little. You open doors and you open hearts, you treat love like it's the finest art. A tiptoe hug, a smile, a wave, a heartfelt tug as you drive away. When you go, as a mother, I know you'll change just a little. Is with you when you go to be there for the highs and lows till we come back home again once more. I know you'll change, but just a little. Our boys. I wrote a song for my daughter too, but I'm not going to do that one tonight. You know, I was asked about a year and a half ago to play a character in a video game and to write the music that this character would be singing in this video game. Well, long story, I know you're all real crazy about video games. You know, Library of Congress. I have to tell you, it comes along with a fake book, So it's about this thick, and the video game is called Fallout 4, and the book that came along with it that you had to know how to read to do, you know, I mean, it was number one on Amazon. So I figure we're all contributing to the literacy of minors, and it puts us musicians to work as well. John Jarvis is my writing partner, and I'm thrilled. He's an incredible musician and writer. And I'm going to let him just tell you a little bit about what the background of what this means to write music for a video game, because it's all about this creative piece that we're here for tonight. It's all about the people that came before us and what's happening now. And, you know, like it or not, video games are here to stay. And so we make money off of it, so, you know.
I told you it'd cost extra if you made me talk, but... Actually, she called me up and she said that she was going to do this character that was a cross between Jessica Rabbit and G.I. Jane, and would I write music with her? And it's like, what do you... And then she went on to explain, I don't know if any of you know this game, but, you know, I've played with tons of people in my life, and all the credits I've ever had have gone away. But nothing means anything, because now I wrote the music for Fallout 4, so that's... Now I'm like a god to the teenagers. But... Anyway, the premise of the movie is that the world ends in, is it 1951, something like that. So she said that in the Armageddon that follows, there's a little bar where this girl sings. So all the songs have to sound like Peggy Lee meets Julie London, but all the subject matter is about bombs falling and clues in the game and all this kind of stuff. So this was actually the first thing that we wrote. It doesn't really have any game clues we're going to give away, but... I think there's a robot bartender or something, but so I guess I'll be the robot piano player, so here you go.
Here we go. It's called Man Enough. This is a lot of fun to do. One time around. They can't be beat. I got eyes that are looking for love, but just need a man who's man enough. I got arms to hold you tight. I got charms to keep you with me at night. I got all that you could ever want. I just need a man who's man enough. I don't need another fabulous lover walking out the door in the morning light. I want a man who can stand on his own without looking for another lover every night. If you got charms and you know how to please, and a smile that makes me weak in the knees. If you're a guy who is looking for love, you might be the one who's man enough. For another lover every night. You got style and you know how to please, and a smile that kicks me weak in the knees. If you're a guy who is gentle and tough, you might be the man Who's man enough? You might be the man who's man enough.
Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome to the stage Library of Congress historian John Cole.
Thank you. I'm speaking tonight both as a historian of the Library of Congress and as someone who's been involved for many years in the Center for the Book in the Library of Congress, which promotes books, reading, and literacy on behalf of the library. But I wanted to talk to you briefly about the building itself, because you are in a very special building, and when you go upstairs for dinner in the Great Hall, there are some things I'd like you to think about that relate to the uniqueness of this particular institution. This is the Thomas Jefferson Building, named after our principal founder. Among his many contributions to the Library of Congress, Jefferson was the first advocate of the idea that this institution, which was created in 1800, should serve the entire nation eventually, as well as serving the Congress. This imposing structure, which you may have noticed as you came in from the outside, has an unusually striking and beautiful interior. The building was opened in 1897, just as our country was rapidly picking up self-confidence, and it's evident in the iconography of this building. We were determined to out-Europe Europe in demonstrating, we wanted to demonstrate our ability to build and decorate an instant national monument, one that simultaneously showed off American painters, sculptors, and especially our writers, whose names are simultaneously shown and their likenesses are all over the walls of what, at this, when it opened in 1897, was called the largest, costliest, and safest library building in the world. Franklin, Emerson, Hawthorne, and Irving are portrayed across the outside front of the building facing the Capitol. In the Great Hall, you will see juxtaposed with the names of great writers from other nations, you'll see Cooper, Bancroft, off to the side hall, you'll find Longfellow, Whittier, Lowell, Bryant, and even Poe and Whitman. In every way, the Jefferson Building and its iconography honor reading, knowledge, and literacy. Thus, it's entirely appropriate that tonight's celebration of reading commemorating the 25th anniversary of the National Literacy Act, signed by President George H.W. Bush. Of course, that's fine. And you may have missed it, but there was a copy of the original act on display upstairs earlier in our reception area with an escort from not only the National Archives, but from the Center for the Book as well. Thus, this is an entirely appropriate setting. We also, though, are celebrating Barbara Bush and the lasting contribution she and the Barbara Bush Foundation the contribution that she and the Foundation for Family Literacy make to the world of reading and literacy. 27 years ago, on January 30th, 1989, as director of the Library's Center for the Book, I accompanied librarian James Billington on a visit to First Lady Barbara Bush on her first day in the White House. She had invited us. She had asked how she might assist in the Library of Congress's forthcoming Year of the Young Reader National Reading Promotion Campaign. She immediately became our honorary chair and just 2 months later launched the campaign by reading aloud to young people in the Great Hall where we'll be having dinner. That was such a new thing in those days. It's not anymore, but it was revolutionary, and she was so eager and helpful to us in getting our reading promotion campaign going. And miracle of miracles, 12 years later, almost immediately after George W. Bush was elected president, Laura Bush invited the Library of Congress to join her in hosting the first National Book Festival. It took place on September 8th, 2001, 3 days before 9/11. I was convinced we would never have another book festival, that the government would feel it had better things to do, but Dr. Billington talked to Mrs. Bush in her office, and she said, oh, by no means, it's more important than ever that we continue with the National Book Festival. And last September, we kicked off the 15th annual National Book Festival. It's on September 24th this year, if you're in town, with a wonderful and inspiring taped message from Mrs. Bush. Finally, in 2013, Dr. Billington persuaded Laura Bush to serve as the honorary chair of the new Library of Congress Literacy Awards, a valuable outreach program initiated and generously funded by David Rubenstein. So now you know for sure, certain that reading, literacy, the Bush family, and the Library of Congress come together in many different combinations that benefit many people. This truly is a cause for celebration. Thank you for joining us tonight.
Well, thank you very much, John. I'm David Rubenstein, and I have the honor of serving as the chairman of the Madison Council of the Library of Congress, which is a support arm of the Library of Congress. And you might wonder why it's named after Mr. Madison. Just briefly, it was actually James Madison's idea to have a Library of Congress. He proposed the idea in, I guess, 1783 under the Articles of Confederation. The Congress got around to doing this, passing a Library of Congress Act in 1800, signed by John Adams. It authorized $5,000 to purchase books for the Library of Congress. They purchased 740 books and three maps, and that's all they had for a while. When the Congress came down here, and the building was across the street, that's where the Library of Congress was until, as you heard from John, the building was built and completed in 1897. Now there are three buildings. This building is named after Thomas Jefferson for the reasons that John mentioned, plus one other that I'll mention. There's a building behind, used to be known as the Annex. That's named after John Adams because John Adams was signed the initial legislation authorizing the Congress, the Library of Congress. And then the Madison building across the street is named after and is a living memorial to the official monument to James Madison in our country's capital. The reason Thomas Jefferson is also a favorite here is because when the British came in 1814 and burned down the Capitol, they also burned down the Library of Congress. And so all the books were gone. And Thomas Jefferson offered to sell his books, about 7,000 books, to the Library of Congress. He actually needed the money at the time. And sold for about $24,000. The Congress went through every single book because Jefferson was seen as a person who might not really believe in Christ, and therefore maybe he'd have some anti-Christian books in his library. So they went through every book and approved every title, and ultimately that became the Library of Congress's library until the books were burned, some of them burned in 1851. And then about 2,000 of the 7,000 or so that he sold were remaining. Ultimately, Jim Billington managed to persuade some donors to repurchase other copies of the books in Jefferson's library, and that's upstairs. It may be open tonight. This is the books that Jefferson had, and the library has pretty much brought them all back together again. So the Library of Congress has done wonderful things, and we are about to have a new Librarian of Congress. Jim Billington served for 28 years, stepped down last year, and I think Congress is about to confirm Carla Hayden, who is the Librarian of Baltimore City, my hometown. And she will hopefully be confirmed relatively soon to be the new Librarian of Congress, the first woman and the first African-American Librarian of Congress. And the importance of what you're all doing by supporting this event tonight and other things you've done is really something I just want to briefly mention. It is incredible that the richest country in the world today still has 36 million people that can't really read. It's hard to believe, but essentially 12% of our population is functionally illiterate, which means they can read at a third grade level or below. And what we learned over the years is that when you have a problem of you can't read, you don't earn very much money. So 45%, nearly half the people who aren't able to read, are in the lowest levels of poverty in our country. And when you can't read, you can't teach your children to read. So you have a chance, if you are a child of somebody who can't read, you have a three-quarters chance of not being able to read very well yourself, and that's a very big disadvantage in life. And of course, as we all know, if you can't read, you have a big chance of getting involved in the criminal justice system. 75% of the people in our prison system essentially are functionally illiterate or dropped out of high school. So the problem of literacy is not one that gets a lot of attention, but it should get a lot of attention, because the truth is that we are a very wealthy country in many ways, but when you can't read, you really can't function very well as an adult in modern civilization. And it's not only illiteracy, but there's one other problem I'd also mention that people should think about, which is illiteracy. 30% of the people who graduate from college in this country never read another book, which is hard to believe. And about half the country's population has not bought a book in the last 5 years or been to a bookstore. So what we want to do is make sure people realize the importance of learning how to read, but also keeping reading as an important habit. And I think all of us are probably people that love books, and you probably wouldn't be here, and you understand the importance of literacy. But I hope you recognize what Barbara Bush Family Literacy Foundation is doing is so important, because we really need to make sure that people learn how to read, and particularly adults, because if adults can't read, they can't teach their children to read. And if children can't learn how to read, they're going to repeat the cycle that their parents had. So it's a very important thing that Barbara Bush did a number of years ago, and I want to thank all of the Bush family who are here tonight for supporting this this very important foundation, and thank, of course, all of you. I would like to mention two final things. One, John Cole, who was just here, created the Center for the Book 40 years ago, and that did incredible things for our country in promoting at the Library of Congress literacy, libraries, and books. And as a result of this, the Library of Congress is now seen much more as the library of the country, not just the Library of Congress. And it's the national library. It's not not a library just for Congress, and that's very important, and John Cole had an enormous amount of influence in making that possible. He also, in the course of his 50 years here, the Library of Congress has written about 400 articles on various subjects relating to literature, literacy, libraries, and he's really been a national treasure for us. And I think all of us are really in his debt. And the American Library Association has recognized this by giving him his their prestigious Lippincott Award a number of years ago, and also one of the Poet Laureates. The Poet Laureate is selected by the Library of Congress. The Poet Laureate, not long ago, wrote a poem in John's honor. Now, I wish I could do something like that. I don't have very good poetry skills. So what I'd like to do is to give him an award on behalf of the Barbara Bush Family Literacy Foundation. And if John, if you would come up, please. I first got involved with the Barbara Bush Family Literacy Foundation because I got to know Barbara Bush and George Herbert Walker Bush, but the most persuasive person was Doro Bush. Doro used to host a celebration of reading in Maryland, and every year she would come and have lunch with me with her sister-in-law Trish, and we would talk about how we were going to organize this, and we'd see who we could raise money from, and we generally did a reasonably good job. They did the hard work of going ahead and raising money. And I got more and more involved in learning about literacy and really recognized that it's as serious a problem as I just tried to mention it briefly a few moments ago. So the person who really helped me think about this was not just Barbara Bush, but Doro Bush. And when I got involved, I began to realize how fortunate I was to be in my own situation, because when I was growing up, neither of my parents graduated from college or high school. They could read, but they were not really book readers. And so when I got my first library card at the age of 6, I was able to go ahead and get books, and it really opened a new world for me. And I've always thought the importance of reading is fundamental to a happy life. And so when I reconnected with the literacy world, and Doro was very persuasive in getting me involved, I really thought it was a great blessing that I got be able to meet with Doro and talk to her about what she was doing. And so she was a real inspiration in getting me involved in the foundation. And I'm really pleased that she's here tonight, and she's done an incredibly steadfast job of promoting this foundation and working tirelessly to make sure that everybody knows the importance of family literacy and the importance of supporting family literacy and the foundation. So it's my honor to introduce the honorary chairman of the Barbara Bush Foundation, Doro.
Good evening. I spend so much time with my mom sometimes that I feel as if I've become her clone, except without the white hair. But spending so much time with her, I've learned to appreciate her deep commitment to her life's passion, literacy, and how we need to strive to make literacy a value in every home. My literacy journey has been filled with wonderful stories and inspired by so many moms, dads, and children who have greatly benefited from the incredible work of Moms Foundation. The foundation's leadership team and board members are dedicated to finding and implementing innovative and bold solutions to the challenging issue of low literacy. On behalf of Mom, I also want to thank each of you for coming tonight and supporting the foundation and their amazing work that's helped millions of Americans over the last 25 years. I've been honored to be part of hosting countless celebrations of reading events throughout the country with dozens of inspirational and talented authors who share their books and their wisdom. Plus, I get to spend time with my amazing sister-in-law, Laura, and my wonderful, I'm going off script, very amusing, niece, Jenna, who also contribute their time and effort to helping raise awareness for family literacy. Even my oversized boxer, Rocky, has been part of my literacy journey. Rocky joined me on the USS George H.W. Bush CVN 77, the ship where I serve as the ship's sponsor. Rocky engaged the shipman's children as we read books and shared tales of life at sea. If you knew Rocky, he's about this tall, and he's a boxer that's legs just kept growing and growing. He had to be carried up the stairs by several shipmen because he was too big to fit. But Rocky did make it up the stairs and almost became the ship's pet. I'll never forget that day because Rocky and I were able to spend time with the families of these brave shipmen who sacrificed their lives for our country. I also travel the country visiting our programs and meeting moms and dads and children who attend our family literacy programs. At a recent event in Maryland, I recall meeting a woman from Guatemala who cried knowing that she would leave the program after her child turned 4 years old. Our family literacy programs became her support group and her second family. And that's what the foundation offers, a support system, hope and opportunity, and a second chance for many adults who felt they were left behind. We're a big family and will continue to grow and succeed for the next 25 years and beyond. I know my mom would love to be here and have been here in person to celebrate with us tonight, especially in a room full of authors, laughter, and literacy. We will make sure to celebrate on her behalf. So, I'm honored to introduce our first author of the evening. He is a dear friend of our family and a renowned historian. John Meacham is a contributing editor at Time, executive editor and executive vice president at Random House, and a Pulitzer Prize-winning author for American Lion, Andrew Jackson in the White House. Now, I'm going to go off script here a minute again. He also has the distinct honor of being the only person to have read my mother's diaries. And my brother Marvin's here tonight, and I can speak for him when we say to you, John, you have our sympathies. John's latest book also focuses on a subject near and dear to Marvin and my heart and Laura's and Jenna's and all my children here and that are here today, and that is my dad. We're so happy that John could join us here this evening to share more about his book, Destiny and Power, The American Odyssey of George Herbert Walker Bush. Please welcome John Meacham.
Thank you, Doro. That was incredibly generous. The generosity reminded me of a moment. I was actually at the National Book Festival about 8 years ago, and whenever I hear words that are kind and warm about me and I begin to think, well, yes, they have a point, my mind goes back. I was on my way to give a talk about Andrew Jackson at the time, and a woman ran up to me, which doesn't happen enough as a basic rule, and said, "Oh my God, it's you." And I said, "Well, yes, you know, existentially speaking, that's hard to argue with." And she said, "Will you wait right here? I want you to sign your new book." And I said, "Yes, ma'am." Hand to God, she brought back John Grisham's latest. No. So whenever I think I have the world right where I want it, I remind myself that there is a woman somewhere in America with a forged copy of The Runaway Jury. So memento mori, as they say. I'm delighted to be here. Doing this book about President Bush was really the honor of a lifetime. I won't tell Doro and Marvin how they came out in the diary, because I agreed with Mrs. Bush on that. I did wear Kevlar occasionally when reading it, because of the sparks that flew off. But President Bush and Mrs. Bush shared their diaries, President Bush's vice presidential diary, his presidential diary, with no restrictions. And if you do what I do for a living, this doesn't happen much. Presidential families are not, frankly, usually that confident in themselves and in the verdict of history. And I think the reason they did it is because they are very comfortable that through the vicissitudes of history, they did the very best they could. And I think that increasingly, as time passes, we're all seeing ever more clearly that the virtues and the skills they brought to the public arena are those that we need now more than ever. So let's begin in Houston at 12:15 a.m. Central Standard Time, November 4th, 1992. Even in the dark, he tried to look ahead. It was late, and he knew he should sleep, but he just couldn't, not yet, anyway. Too much had happened. Too much was on his mind. In the Houstonian Hotel, Suite 271, on the evening he lost his bid for a second term as President of the United States, George Herbert Walker Bush climbed out of bed and slipped into an adjoining wood-paneled living room. Weary but restless, he settled on a small sofa. The room was empty, his heart full. There he sat, alone, struggling to make peace with the news that he, an American president who embodied the experience of the World War II generation, had just been defeated by Bill Clinton, the baby boomer Democratic governor of Arkansas. In his private tape-recorded diary, Bush dictated, "I ache, and now I must think. How do you keep your chin up, keep your head up through a couple of difficult days ahead?" He kept his voice low. Barbara, his devoted wife of 47 years, was asleep back in the bedroom. "I think of our country and the people that are hurting, and there is so much we didn't do," Bush told his diary. "And yes, progress that we made, but no, the job is not finished, and that kills me." Not so long before, it had been all different. George Bush had always finished the job. From his earliest days, he had done what his parents, his teachers, and his country had asked of him. He had not only met expectations, but exceeded them time and again. Born in 1924, he was a son of privilege raised in Greenwich, Connecticut, and at the seaside Walker's Point in Kennebunkport, Maine. He had joined the Navy on his 18th birthday. As a carrier-based bomber pilot in the Pacific in World War II, He had been shot down at the age of 20, but had finished his mission, attacking an enemy radio tower on Chichijima, even after his plane had been hit. He had raised a family, lost a daughter to leukemia, built a business, and thrived in the treacherous world of American politics. As President of the United States, he had ended the Cold War, lifting the specter of nuclear war from the life of the nation and of the world, and led a global coalition to military victory in the Middle East. The economy, however, had slipped into a recession, leading to a persistent public sense that he was a rich man out of touch with the concerns of the people in his care. The caricature wasn't fair, but as Bush often said, politics never was. On this election night, he had said the gracious things, calling the president-elect in Little Rock to concede the race and promise a smooth transition. Yet the loss, Bush dictated, hurt, 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 and I guess it's the pride, too. It was surely the pride, too. Not a doubt in the world about that. He dictated, "I don't like to see the pollsters right at the end. I don't like to see the pundits right. I don't like to see all of those who have written me off right. I was absolutely convinced that we would prove them wrong, but I was wrong and they were right, and that hurts a lot. I still feel that there is a disconnect. Honor, duty, country. It's just passé. The values are different now, the lifestyles, the accepted vulgarity, the manners, the view of what's patriotic and what's not, the concept of service. All these are in the hands of a new generation now, and I feel I have the comfort of knowing that I have upheld these values, and I live and stand by them. I have the discomfort of knowing that they might be a little out of date." Honor, duty, country. Those verities, together with a driving ambition and an abiding competitive spirit, had shaped his life and his understanding of the nation. There was nothing affected about Bush's vision of politics as a means to public service, and of public service as the highest of callings. For now, though, Bush needed a way forward through the shadows of defeat, and he returned to a few core truths that had always guided him. Be strong, he told himself in the living room musings. Be kind, be generous of spirit, be understanding. Let people know how grateful you are. Don't get even. Comfort the ones I've hurt and let down. Say your prayers and ask for God's understanding and strength. Finish with a smile and with some gusto. Do what's right and finish strong. With that, the 41st President of the United States retired for the night, rejoining the sleeping Barbara. Now he had a plan. Now he could rest. He told himself something else, too, in the days after the defeat. It'll change, he dictated. It'll change. And so it did. The farther the country moved from his presidency, the larger Bush loomed, and the qualities so many voters found to be vices in 1992 came to be seen as virtues. His public reticence, his old-fashioned dignity, his tendency to find a middle course between extremes. He lived long enough to see the shift, and he appreciated that people were taking a more benign view of his record. Amid a conference at his presidential library in 2014, his 90th year, a visitor asked him what he made of all the encomiums and positive revision of his legacy. Hard to believe, Bush remarked. It's kinder and gentler all over the place. Americans unhappy with the reflexively polarized politics of the first decades of the 21st century will find the presidency of George H.W. Bush refreshing, even quaint. He embraced compromise as a necessary element of public life, engaged his political foes in the passage of important legislation, and was willing to break with the base of his own party to do what he thought was right, whatever the price. Quaint, yes, but it happened in America only a quarter of a century ago. There's a letter, and I would get the ball patrol ready, as the Bush family refers to it, as Christopher Buckley once said, George Herbert Walker Bush has the Sicilian, the tear ducts of a Sicilian grandmother, which is kind of unfair to Sicilian grandmothers, actually. But in the late 1950s, George W. Bush, Jeb, the births of Neil and Marvin, Bush was in the midst of the busiest of lives. Doro had not yet been born. And President Bush wrote a letter to his mother that was found in his her papers at the end of her life about the loss of their daughter Robin to leukemia in 1953. This is the voice of George Herbert Walker Bush, a man, and this is the real George H.W. Bush that enough people still don't know, but this is the one that so many of us do. He wrote his mother, "There is about our house a need, the running, pulsating restlessness of the four boys as they struggle to learn and grow. The world embraces them. But all this wonder needs a counterpart. We need some starched, crisp frocks to go with all our torn-kneed blue jeans and helmets. We need some soft blonde hair to offset those crew cuts. We need a dollhouse to stand firm against our forts and rackets and 1,000 baseball cards. We need a legitimate Christmas angel, one who doesn't have cuffs beneath the dress. We need someone who's afraid of frogs. We need someone to cry when I get mad, not argue. We need a little one who can kiss without leaving egg or jam or gum. We need a girl. We had one once. She'd fight and cry and play and make her way just like all the rest. But there was about her a certain softness. She was patient. Her hugs were just a little less wiggly. Like them, she'd climb in to sleep with me, but somehow she'd fit. She'd stand beside our bed till I felt her there. Silently and comfortable, she'd put those precious, fragrant locks against my chest and fall asleep. Her peace made me feel strong and so very important. My daddy had a caress, a certain ownership, which touched a slightly different spot than the hi, Dad, I love so much. But she is still with us. We need her, and yet we have her. We can't touch her, and yet we can feel her. We hope she'll stay in our house for a long, long time." In the course of doing the book, I asked the president to read that letter aloud to me one day in his office in Houston. And long before he finished, he broke down with extraordinary level of physical sobs, so much so that my friend Jean Becker, his chief of staff, heard what was going on and came in. And she realized what had happened, and she said, "Why did you want President Bush to read that?" And I said, "Well, if you want to know someone's heart," and before I could finish, the president said, "You have to know what breaks it." I'll leave you with this. In the end, after he lies in state in the Capitol Rotunda, after the funeral service at Washington National Cathedral, after the hymns and the flags and the tributes and the tears, after the last flight home to Texas, George H.W. Bush will come to rest in a quiet graveyard tucked behind a grove of trees across a small stream from his presidential library in College Station. There he and Barbara are to be buried next to Robin. It is a serene spot, but close enough to the world that a visitor can't help but hear the subtle rumble of traffic on the Texas highways and the occasional roar of a plane. Bush will be interred beneath an enormous iron seal of the presidency of the United States, at peace but not far from the sounds of lives still moving, still striving, which is fitting, for he never really stopped either. Once, when he was nearing 90, a hurricane was about to hit the Maine coast. As the storm came in, Walker's Point was being boarded up. The power was out, and there were 50-mile-per-hour winds. The rain had just stopped briefly when Jean Becker, the 41st President's chief of staff, realized she did not know where Bush was. She went from room to room in the house. No Bush. Finally, she peeked out the door and saw the former president of the United States on a scooter on the putting green, looking out at the stormy sea. There he sat on the stony shoreline, near the cottage path where he had learned to walk and the rocks where he had played as a child. This was the place he had proposed marriage and raised his children and grandchildren and now great-grandchildren. This was the place he had received heads of state. This was the place he had contemplated war and peace. This was the place he always returned to in hours of victory and of defeat, in good times and in bad. He gazed off into the distance, his still auburn hair riffling, his jacket pressed against his body, his eyes scanning the horizon. The winds were so strong that the Secret Service agents around Bush could barely stand, but there Bush sat serenely. Becker struggled through the winds to his side. "Mr. President, what are you doing, sir?" He looked at her with a puzzled expression, as if the answer were obvious. "I can't see anything from the house," he replied, just audible over the whooshing weather, "and I don't want to miss anything."
Good evening. I'm Margaret Bush, and I'm married to the marvelous Marvin Bush. As you know, literacy has been a theme in the Bush family for decades now. In addition to being avid readers, we've got several accomplished authors. I'm so pleased to introduce two of those authors, my sister-in-law, former First Lady Laura Bush, and my niece, Jenna Bush Hager. As most of you know, Laura is a former teacher and librarian and a devoted supporter of literacy and education worldwide. She's also the author of a best-selling memoir and founded both the Texas Book Festival and the National Book Festival here in Washington, D.C. Today, she is the chair of the Women's Initiative at the George W. Bush Institute. Jenna is also an author, former teacher, and currently serves as a correspondent for NBC's Today Show and editor-at-large for Southern Living. She is also the mother of two of the most adorable Bush family members, 3-year-old Mila and 9-month-old Poppy Louise. Together, Laura and Jenna have co-authored 2 children's books. Their latest book, Our Great Big Backyard, is helping to commemorate the 100th anniversary of the National Park Service. Please join me in welcoming to the stage Laura Bush and Jenna Bush.
Thank you very much, Margaret. We appreciate you very much. And thank you, John. Although, Jenna's not going to be able to read.
I don't want to thank you, John. First, in the photo line, my mom said we were acting like my 2-year-old, 3-year-old Mila, because he was making me laugh with all of his jokes, and then he made me cry. So no thanks to you.
Jenna and I are so happy to be here, so we can thank all of you, everyone here, for joining our cause for literacy. Barbara Bush is very sorry that she can't join us today. We left her in Maine. She felt like, since she celebrated her 91st birthday yesterday, that she could play the age card. She asked me to thank each of you for your generous support for the Barbara Bush Foundation for Family Literacy. And it certainly is a family affair here at the Library of Congress. You've already heard from Daro and Margaret, and a few more Bush family members will speak later in the program. President Bush 41 and President Bush 43 asked that I make sure to send their best to everyone here tonight.
And my daughters, Mila and Poppy, wish they could be here, although one is only 9 months, so it's past her bedtime. And they are currently being babysat by their jefe, my father, and disciplined by the enforcer, my grandmother. 3-year-old Mila has become quite the literacy expert. She loves to memorize her favorite books and read them to her baby sister. But I guess with a great-grandmother like Barbara Bush, and a librarian as a grandmother, you could never expect anything less. Mila and Poppy, and now I probably will cry. I have cried at my bio once at a speech. So I think I take the cake. If that, they were like, she is the proud mother of Mila Hager. And, yes, I am. I was pregnant. But anyway, Mila and Poppy are actually the inspiration for our new book, Our Great Big Backyard. We wrote the book on maternity leave, and I think when I was looking down, like, I wrote the book on maternity leave. My mother edited the book while I was on maternity leave. But I think when I look down at my little baby, who incidentally is named after my grandfather, and I thought about everything I wanted for my girls, I also reflected on what made our childhood, my sister Barbara, and my childhood such a happy one. And almost all of my favorite memories were spent outside. As kids, Barbara and I spent hours exploring the drain pipes and sewers of our neighborhood. My mom says they weren't sewers, but they were. Which turned suburban Dallas into something really magical. My favorite memories with my dad were spent at a lake in East Texas, which we were thrilled about till we found out there were alligators and we couldn't swim. Every night after dinner, he would say, who wants to take a night walk? And of course, now I'm gonna cry because I just can't help it. My hand went up. I always did. And when I looked back, I realized now it wasn't just the love of being outside. It was also the uninterrupted time with people that I love. So now that technology, and we've talked about video games already, nothing wrong with a video game here or there, but now that technology is in the hands of my girls at even 3 years old and in their mother and their father, I know that uninterrupted time is less likely for my daughters. But I hope that they have the opportunity to put the electronics down and see how magical being outside really can be.
So when Jenna was on maternity leave with Poppy, she called and said, Mom, it's time to write another book. And so I said, Jenna, get to work. And since this August marks the 100 years of our National Park Service, and I'm the co-chair of the centennial celebration with Mrs. Obama, I knew it was the perfect time to recognize our nation's best idea, our national parks.
I'm not sure if you all know this, but my mom is a proud nerd of our national parks. She calls herself that. Every year, she and her childhood best friends have explored a different park. And one year, they actually brought their daughters along, and they've never invited us back again. I think the tent was just a little too small for the two of us. But I wish you could have seen us. The first night we got there, a sandstorm blew in, and my mom wore hard contacts, so she had to get some goggles to protect herself, and I was leading her around from place to place. A nerd indeed.
So Jenna wrote the book, and I edited it, and our talented illustrator, Jacqueline Rogers, brought our story to life. When you write your own book, you can include little secret symbols and references to everyone you love. You may be able to pick some of these out in the illustrations, but we'll point out just a few as well.
And so it's not exactly a Pulitzer Prize winner, John, but we're now, it's a little embarrassing, but we're thrilled to share with you the journey of Jane, a little girl who takes her eyes from her iPad and starts to look at the starry skies of our national parks and in her own backyard.
Our great big backyard.
Huddle, my BFF Hank said. I have our whole glorious summer mapped out. Awesome, stupendous, super duper.
Hank's summer plans. Hank wanted to watch a different movie every day. Ricky was going to create a YouTube channel. Louise and I couldn't wait to have an epic starship tournament.
iPads, video games, Wi-Fi, oh my. It was going to be the best summer of our lives, but that was before.
That night.
Oh, you go ahead.
That night, Mom gave me the bad news. We're going to spend the summer on a road trip.
Dad's map was different from Hank's, but I was supposed to spend it with my friends.
Jane, there's more to life than staring at a screen. You'll love being on the open road.
As if I didn't have enough to worry about, my pest of a brother, Sam, kept bothering me. Come on. That's named after our cousin, Sam LeBlanc. Come on, Jane, let's go outside. We'll practice camping. No way. I'm busy.
On the last day of school, my parents picked me up for what they called the Great American Road Trip. If you'll notice, oh wait, not on
not
this
yet.
Page.
I sent my friends a message. I sent my friend, and we used to have a minivan that looked just like this with the wooded panels. So when we said the illustrator, can you please make it baby blue? I sent my friends a message. I'm leaving on a road trip. Don't know when I'll be back again. Oh boy, I hate to go.
As we drove south, my parents sang along to show tunes.
How humiliating. At least I had their phone to keep me company.
Jane, put that away. You're missing some beautiful sights.
All I'm missing is time with my friends.
First stop, Everglades National Park. Swamp, cypress trees with creepy hanging moss, and mosquitoes as far as the eye could see.
Big deal. There's absolutely nothing to see here.
If you'll notice, HH is on the canoe. That's Henry Hager, Jenna's husband, who was an Eagle Scout.
Yes, my mom loves to report that fact to everybody we see. Jenna's husband was an Eagle Scout.
We drove forever to get to our next stop. As we crossed the Mississippi River, Sam waved to a riverboat captain.
I hid behind my iPad. Ahoy, matey!
Next stop, Big Bend National Park. I couldn't wait to get out of the car so I could finally play Starship. Jane, please put that away. Come look through the telescope. I love the way the illustrator lit Jane's face with her iPad in this illustration.
Oh, wow. The sky in Texas was huge and bright. Then bless my lucky stars, a meteor shower lit up the sky like fireworks, brighter than any screen I had ever seen. And if you notice, oh, can you go back, whoever's doing our pictures, to this picture right here with the telescope? There's a JW on that.
On the telescope, that's my mother, Jenna Welch, who was the one that would put a blanket on the lawn in the summer, and we'd lie on the blanket, and she'd point out the constellations. We traveled west across the desert. Sam and I pretended like we were astronauts on Mars, and noticed the golf bag here and the number on the golf bag. 43.
Does anybody know what 43 stands for?
Next stop, Grand Canyon National Park.
We tiptoed over the skywalk like acrobats on a tightrope. The river so far below looked like a shiny ribbon.
As we explored, I sent a selfie to my crew.
Yep, that's me on Blaze, my mule. The only thing missing is you, XOXO.
When we rafted down the Colorado River, I was a pirate captain with Sam as my first mate, navigating treacherous waters.
And there's also a number on the front of that boat, 41. Anybody? Somebody that loves being on the sea.
Next stop, Yellowstone National Park.
We were park rangers on the lookout for animals. Mountain lions, buffaloes, and bears. Oh my.
What did the park ranger say to the skunk?
Smell you later, take a hike. I thought I created that joke, but I read it at school, and turns out I didn't.
If you notice, there's a little asterisk by the buffalo on the left side of the page. We put that there, and below it says, Americans call this a buffalo, but it's really a bison.
And these are the types of things you learn while you're writing a book about the national parks.
Also, you may have just heard that the bison was just named the American mammal.
I sort of thought humans were the American mammal, but...
Next, still here at Yellowstone, we waited and waited for Old Faithful to explode in the air.
Then finally, 5, 4, 3, 2, 1, blast off!
It was like a real starship shooting off into space.
And if you notice on the starship, we named it the Enforcer, because she is like a ship in her force.
You can see her in the illustration down at the very bottom with her white hair and her sunglasses.
Although she would never wear that type of tank top.
The Enforcer herself. Last stop, Yosemite National Park.
Sam and I served our last dinner on the road. Fireflies hung in the air like fluttering stars. We pretended we were cowboys.
Oh, my darling. Oh, my darling.
You didn't think you were going to get to hear that, did you?
Jenna's always been wondering what's in the cup there of the mother.
It looks like they've had a long trip and she's finally enjoying some wine. The mountain went up and up and up, straight into the sky, watching over us. I felt really small, but really great too, like I was part of something big. Oh no! The next morning, I couldn't find my most prized possession, my tablet.
Jane, you packed it away a week ago.
How could I possibly tell my friends we're coming home? Wait. I got it. Dear Hank, hi from Yosemite. You'd love it here. Be home soon. XX Jane. What did you like the best? I asked Sam.
The campfires.
I thought about all of the stars. I'm going to miss our big adventure. And I love that Jacqueline Rogers drew a little picture of two girls playing with a star above them and an M and P.
In the book. Can you see in the little book?
Y'all probably can't see any of these
Mila
pictures.
Mila and Poppy Lou.
I was sad when we got home, but then I took Baxter into our backyard and I had a brilliant idea. Mom, can my friends come over for a camp out?
I told Hank and Ricky and Louise all about the places we'd seen.
I had the best summer after all. It's spectacular out there.
Just then, a shooting star zoomed across the sky.
Look, it's beautiful right here in our own backyard.
Okay, let's go out the other side. Okay.
Thanks, everybody.
I wouldn't give up on the Pulitzer yet. How's everybody doing tonight? All right, I know a lot of people in here. I know we can do a little bit better than that. How is everybody doing tonight? All right. I am Sam LeBlond, and I'm honored to be a part of tonight's celebration. A.J. Jacobs is best known for his humor, or as A.J. puts it, he is an author, a journalist, a lecturer, and a human guinea pig. Ganny says his wife must be a saint. In 2007, A.J. turned to his spiritual side to write The Year of Living Biblically, one man's humble quest to follow the Bible as literally as possible. This book put A.J. on a mission to follow the hundreds of instructions in the good book, including well-known commands like love thy neighbor and often ignored ones like do not wear clothes of mixed fibers. I know that one got kind of interesting. Growing up as a member of the Bush family, I always thought that I came from a big family, but AJ's latest project has put that into perspective. He's helping to build a family tree of the entire world, illustrating that we are all related. His global family reunion last summer attracted 10,000 people, or cousins, as he calls them, from around the world. It's kind of like our get-togethers. We are so pleased that he's here to share his experiences with us tonight. So let's join as one big, happy family and welcome Mr. A.J. Jacobs.
Thank you. Thank you. I'm delighted to be here at this wonderful event. Thank you to Barbara Bush and Doro and Sam and many other Bushes and non-Bushes alike. This is a wonderful cause, and literacy is a cause that's close to my heart because not only do I write books for a living, but many of my books are about the act of reading, books about books. And Sam mentioned this in the intro. A few years ago, I wrote a book about the Bible. And this came about because I grew up with no religion at all. As I say in the book, I'm Jewish, but I'm Jewish in the same way the Olive Garden is Italian, which is not fair. No offense to the Olive Garden, great breadsticks. But I like the Olive Garden fans. But I had just had a son, and I wanted to know what to teach him about my heritage. And I thought one way to learn about the Bible would be to actually live it, to immerse myself in it. That's what I like to do as a writer, to dive in. So I decided I'm going to try to spend a year following all the rules of the Bible as literally as possible. And I wanted to see which ones are going to make my life better and which ones are going to make my life not so much better at all. So I got a board of spiritual advisors. I got rabbis and ministers and priests, and I went ahead and I made a list of all the rules in the Bible. And it turns out that's a pretty long list. That is over 700 rules, and I wanted to follow them all. So I wanted to follow the famous ones, the Ten Commandments, and love your neighbor, be fruitful and multiply. And I was fruitful. I did multiply. I had twin boys. So I take my books very seriously. But as Sam mentioned, I also wanted to follow the less famous rules. The Bible says in Leviticus, it says, you cannot shave the corners of your beard. I didn't know where the corners were, so I thought, safest thing, let the whole thing grow. And by the end, I had some serious topiary. Thank you. Thank you for the moon. As you might guess, I spent a lot of time at airport security. That is true. And it was there I am in the central. Now, full disclosure, I did dress in the robe and sandals, but the sheep was a rental sheep. So that was just for the cover shoot. But the other stuff was legit. And it was the most challenging year of my life. First of all, I had to avoid all sorts of sins. The Bible says you cannot covet or lie or gossip. And I'm a journalist, and I live in New York City. So that's like 80% of my day, right there, shot. So it was a radical life change. It was also challenging because I was trying to follow some rules that don't quite jive with modern American customs. And one that pops to mind is stoning adulterers. The Hebrew scriptures say that you should stone adulterers many times. So I thought I should at least try. And very quickly, I was able to stone one adulterer. I was in Central Park, and a man came up to me, and he said, why are you dressed like that? And I said, well, I'm trying to follow all the rules of the Bible, from the Ten Commandments to stoning adulterers. And he says, well, I'm an adulterer. Are you going to stone me? And I said, well, yeah, that would be fantastic. I mean, thank you for this opportunity. And I took out a handful of stones, because I had been carrying stones around for weeks, hoping to run into an adulterer. And I showed him, they were very small, they were like pebble size, I didn't want to go to jail for life. He was a very aggressive adulterer. He grabbed the stones out of my hand and threw them at my face. So an eye for an eye, also in the Bible, I thought, all right, I can throw one back at him. So I crossed that off my list. Now, at the end of the year, I did stop stoning adulterers. I shaved off my beard. But there were dozens of lessons and takeaways from this year that still stay with me. It was actually a life-changing and profound year. And I will just give you one that I feel is relevant to tonight's cause, and that is gratitude. Because the Bible says you should be grateful for everything. And I took that literally. So I was I would press the elevator button, and I'd be thankful that the elevator came. I would get in the elevator. I'd be thankful it didn't plummet to the basement and break my collarbone, and on all day long. And it was a strange way to live, but it was also wonderful because it made very clear that there are thousands of things that happen every day that we totally take for granted. And we focus on the three or four that go wrong, or at least I did. So it's a radical change in perspective that I have tried to keep. And I want to say how grateful I am to be part of this wonderful community that the Bushes have created, and that is sharing this amazing gift of literacy. Speaking of community, I want to close by quickly telling you about the new project I'm working on, the other one that Sam mentioned. And this one came about because about 2 years ago, I got an email from a man, and he said, "Dear AJ, you don't know me, but I'm your 12th cousin." So naturally, I figure the next line is going to be, "Here's my bank account in Nigeria. Please wire $10,000. But it turns out he was not asking for money. Instead, he's part of a group of researchers and scientists who are revolutionizing family trees. Because it used to be a family tree. If it was big, it was a couple hundred people. That was considered big. Now, these trees are exploding. And they're not trees, they're forests. They're like Amazons of family trees. And they're exploding for two reasons. And the first is DNA testing. You can spit into a tube and they'll send you back a list of cousins you never knew you had. And there's one. This is my result, actually. One of the cousins I didn't know I had was my wife. So that was an itch. Yeah. So I thought that was interesting and it would spice up our marriage, but she was freaked out, so what are you gonna do? But it's fine, it's, you know, we're seventh cousins and none of our kids have two heads, so we're fine. But the second reason is the digital revolution, which is allowed us to combine family trees online. So there are these super massive mega family trees online that thousands of people are collaborating at the same time all over the world to build this big tree. And I'm on something that's called the World Family Tree, which is just one of them. And this has over 100 million people, all of them related by blood or marriage, or in my case, both, to my wife. And it's in 160 countries, and I'm on this tree. Many of my childhood friends are on this tree, and most exciting, Mrs. Barbara Bush is on this tree. So this is how I'm related to Barbara Bush, is she is officially my first cousin once removed son's, fourth great grandfather's niece's, sister-in-law's, third great nephew's wife. So practically my older sister is what I'm thinking. And I'm very proud of this. I don't know how she feels, but I'm excited. And of course, that means I'm related to all the other Bushes. So here's how Laura and Jenna are my cousins. So come to Passover next year. You guys are invited. And Mrs. Bush is also related to Abraham Lincoln, much more closely, actually, sixth cousin five times removed, Abraham Lincoln, to Mrs. Bush. And, you know, it's not all good news. I found out that the serial killer Jeffrey Dahmer is my cousin, but he's through my wife's side, so I just want to make that clear. And so what is amazing to me is that in a few years, this is going to grow exponentially. I think that was talked about yesterday, exponentially. And that there will be a super tree that connects every single person in this room, every single person in this city, in this country, in this world. And this idea of the family of humankind, it's not a cliche anymore. It's a scientific fact, a real concrete fact. And it has huge implications. There are scientific implications. Scientists are studying this tree to see how diseases are passed down, and it's going to lead to medical breakthroughs. It's got social implications. It's like the ultimate social network. It's like LinkedIn on steroids. And I was able to meet some of my cousins around the country as part of this project. So I got to meet my cousins, President and Mrs. Bush, and various Daniel Radcliffe. That made my nieces happy, and a Sports Illustrated model named Chrissy Teigen. I thought it was important to meet her, and various other people. And I just love this idea that we are all related. And to celebrate, I decided over the summer to throw a family reunion, the global family reunion. So I invited all 7 billion cousins of mine to attend. Some couldn't make it, but as Sam mentioned, we got about 4,000 cousins at the main festival in New York. Plus, we had simultaneous reunions all around the world, in New Zealand, in Mexico, and there were 10,000 cousins there. We had a rabbi, a reverend, and an imam, which is not a joke, when they actually came and did a blessing. Of course, we had Sister Sledge come to sing We Are Family, and the message was simple. It was their message, we are family, and my hope is, and the hope of many people working on this, is that the clearer this becomes, the more obvious and scientifically proven it is that we're all one big family, the hope is that it will break down tribalism and make us realize it's not us versus them. It's just us. That's it. Every human on Earth shares 99.9% of our DNA. Which is just bad news for bigots. And if we can hammer this home, maybe we can treat each other with a little more kindness. And social scientists talk about this. They call it the family bias. We have a bias to treat our family, even distant relatives, better than strangers. And, you know, it's not perfect. I have 3 sons, and I see how they wrestle. So I know that it's, you know, not every family gets along together perfectly. But overall, in humans, there's a bias to treat family better. And there was a fascinating recent study by Tel Aviv University of Israelis and Palestinians. And when they were shown how genetically similar they were more willing to negotiate, they were more open-minded. And this idea of one big family, it makes you care about your cousins. You want them to succeed. You want them, for instance, to learn to read. You want them to benefit from the wonderful work, for instance, that the Barbara Bush Literacy Foundation does. So thank you, my cousins, and I will see you soon.
Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome the President and CEO of the Barbara Bush Foundation for Family Literacy, Liza McFadden.
Good evening. AJ, thank you so much. You're always so funny, and we love it. And I come with gratitude. He talked about gratitude. The very first time that I met Mrs. Bush in 1991, I remember her saying to me, I never feel like my day starts right unless I start off with writing thank you letters. So from me to all of us at the Barbara Bush Foundation, thank you so much for your support this evening. It means the world to us, and it allows us to do what we do. I'd also like to thank our official airline partner, Southwest Airlines, and you should all watch your emails after this evening's event, as someone will receive a nice surprise. At the Barbara Bush Foundation, we believe simply that education is a civil right, no matter your age. And so, the money that we raise here tonight will go to expand literacy services in Virginia, D.C., and Maryland, and it is desperately needed. Low literacy and a lack of access to education contributes to a multi-generational cycle of social and economic disadvantage. Just to give you a fact, here in D.C., 85% of children under the age of 6 who live in low-income homes have parents who have never graduated from high school. And in public schools here, 56% of fourth graders are not reading on grade level. We can do more, we must do more, and we will do more with your generous support. So, our gratitude and thanks. Now, I'd like to share a short video about family literacy program right here in Washington, D.C., that is empowering local families through education and was begun with a small grant from the Barbara Bush Foundation many years ago.
Berea Public Charter School is a family literacy charter school. It's unique. It's the only one in the country. We provide both adult education and early childhood education for the children who come with their parents to school. We started with federal funding and funding from the Barbara Bush Foundation in the late 80s. We have been able to address the challenges in adult education by being able to change policies in the District of Columbia. We are receiving funding per pupil, stable funding, just like a K-12 school would receive. This unique model allows parents to be able to gain their skills from learning how to write and read all the way up to high school and getting their high school diploma alongside their children who are getting all the skills that they need to be successful. We have also been able to partner with Mary Center, a federally qualified health center that allows us to provide all the support services such as health care and social services to families so that they can really focus on their education and then getting a job and helping their families.
Adult students face a lot of challenges that young people don't face. They have to support their families financially, care for their children, and get around. As educators and as a school, we try to address those challenges by creating a support network, letting the students know that they're wanted here, that we miss them if they don't show up, and also networking them with a lot of support services within Mary Center, within the school, and within the community.
We have some of the highest outcomes in adult education in the country. We also are able to see how our families grow and are able to be successful in the workforce. We have 77% of our students gaining employment. Over 90% of our students retain their employment. We also see amazing outcomes with the children by being able to have an ecosystem with parents and children learning together and parents being involved in their education. After 26 years, we know what works. First is to have a stable funding stream for adult education, equal to those in K through 12. And secondly, that we not work in a silo. We see adults as parents, workers, and community members. And we create systems so that policies can go across departments and across programs.
It's a very rewarding place to work, and I feel a really strong relationship with the students. I see them around in the community a lot, both current students and after they've left the program, and we always hug. They tell us regularly that we're their family. I feel really lucky to be able to work in a program like this.
There is no better way to express our gratitude once again than for me to ask Maria Elena Moreno Van Maren and her family to join us. Maria is from Columbia originally, and she is the mother of two children, and she's working toward her high school diploma at Berea Public Charter School. Her two-year-old daughter started in the infant program at Berea and is now in the toddler program. We're so happy that Maria and her family were able to join us. Maria?
Only I want to say thank you very much. Thank you so much for this amazing idea. You guys got it. Because we can see how our families grow up now, and that's what we need to be a growing together. Education together with families, amazing. Thank you so much, the Foundation Barbara Bush. Thank you very much.
Good evening. I'm Gigi Cook, and I'm so happy to be here tonight with family and friends to celebrate reading. When my grandmother, Barbara Bush, and my mom, Dora Bush Cook, were working to instill a love of reading in me and my siblings, they knew the importance of finding just the right book to capture our interest. Whether you're 6 years old or 60, There's nothing quite like a book that engrosses you to the point that you just can't put it down. Our next author, David Baldacci, knows a lot about page-turners, having written some of the most memorable thrillers in recent history. All 32 of his novels for adults have been national and international bestsellers, and several have been adapted for film and television. Not surprisingly, his latest book, The Last Mile, shot straight to the top of the bestsellers list in April. And like Gani, David has a true passion for literacy. Please help me welcome veteran Celebration of Reading guest author, David Baldacci.
You know, Gigi will not remember this, of course. The last time I saw her, she was 5. And she was scolding my son, who was also 5, because he had locked himself in the bathroom at Walker's Point. And they had to break the window to get him out. I was told later it was a 105-year-old window. And his mother was so proud, I can tell you that. And apparently he left something behind, too, because when we got back from Walker's Point, about a week later, we got a Federal Express package from Barbara Bush, and inside was a very tiny pair of Tasmanian boxer shorts. Not something I ever expected to get from a former First Lady. And there was a note there that said that she had checked with George and they were not his. My wife and I started our family foundation to promote literacy about 15 years ago, really directly inspired by Barbara Bush, who has done so much work in that over the years and has really been a visionary for that field. And I know she's inspired many, many others to do the same thing. And I'm passionate about literacy really because Barbara Bush made me passionate about it. This is a story that I wrote for Lonely Planet. I usually write thrillers, but I write some other stuff too. It's a travelogue, and it's called Coming Home. It was supposed to be a family summer holiday to Italy in 2008, a treat for my wife and our teenage daughter and son. We were leasing a villa in Tuscany with two other couples. Months before we flew out, I received an email from the mayor of Barga, Italy, a city in the Lucca province in Tuscany. He wrote that he had read I would be coming to Italy to vacation. Not really sure where he read that. And he very much wanted me to be his guest for lunch. So I had intended to bring my family to Barga for a very special reason. It was the birthplace of my grandfather, Amedeo Giovanni Vittorio Baldacci. That's Italian, by the way, if you didn't guess. I had never met him because he died tragically of pneumonia long before I was born. But I had heard a great deal about this 6-foot-4-inch Italian immigrant who had come through Ellis Island and then headed straight south, getting off the train in Richmond, Virginia, my hometown, where he met my grandmother, a full 18 inches shorter than he, at the boarding house run by her mother. He owned several successful businesses in Richmond, including a confectionery, a restaurant, an aerial sightseeing business, and unfortunately a coal mine that produced far more water than coal. Everyone in Richmond called the tall, handsome Rudolph Valentino lookalike Mike, as apparently Amedeo, Giovanni, and Vittorio were too much for Southern tongues to handle. He and my grandmother produced 8 children over a 15-year period, my father being roughly in the middle of the pack. The year 2008 had particular significance for me in a sad way. My father had passed away in May. He had never been to Barga, and the closest he ever got was fighting in World War II. I had planned the trip long before he passed with the thought that I would bring back all these wonderful stories of the birthplace of his father. And while I could no longer do that, I could still go as his informal representative. I wrote back to the mayor, and I said I would certainly travel to Barga, and I would be bringing family and friends. In August, we flew to Rome and took a train to Florence, where we rented a car and began our journey to the villa on top of a hill about an hour south of Florence. However, as we flew close to the destination, the GPS's automated voice said warningly, "I'm losing power, you will be lost here forever." As it spoke in Italian, my wife and I were just guessing about that. We raced like mad down the autostrada, got off at an exit, and watched the dire GPS doomsday warnings continue. And then with a series of little beeps, like a hospital vitals monitor forecasting the end, the GPS went off to the navigation graveyard, leaving us wondering where the hell we were. You may know this, but I have since learned that the system known as Never Lost in the U.S. is actually referred to in Italy has always lost. We tried to contact the other two couples on our cell phones, but those two apparently had gone to the same high-tech cemetery as the GPS. We simply kept getting a lovely voice speaking Italian, with it just being, "You're screwed." We eventually reached the village and found a rescue squad team relaxing under an August sun. In our very poor Italian, we tried to make them understand what we wanted. They were pleasant and kind and had no idea what we were saying. Finally, one of them climbed onto his official EMT scooter, turned on his emergency lights, and signaled for us to follow. We did so, and then we began to climb on sickening switchbacks and near vertical inclines, and I thought our poor car was just going to pull out a gun and shoot itself. The man on the scooter finally stopped, and I pulled up next to him. "Are we there yet?" I asked, hoping that he would simply say "si," or perhaps "va bene," which was about the extent of my friendship with the local language. Instead, he simply waved us on. My wife looked at me and said, "I think he wants us to keep going." And we did, while our Italian chum turned and headed back down the mountain astride his all-terrain emergency vehicle with a cool light to safety. We wound our way over gravel roads and then to what seemed like no roads. Along the way, we rounded curves where the 2-foot-wide road was cut into the mountainside and the drop down was a couple thousand feet with nothing between death and us except air. I had a terrifying vision that the helpful EMTs might be the ones to retrieve our bodies from the wreckage. Along the way, we ran into another couple coming from the other direction. After discussing the matter, we decided to just go for it. I gunned the car and we charged headlong up the mountain, the light brigade in Tuscany, gears gnashing, trying to gain traction for the tires, clouds of gray smoke coating the cars. It was like we were attempting a run across the moon's surface in a 4-cylinder Peugeot. And then we finally had given up virtually all hope. We arrived. The villa was beautiful, the grounds exquisite, the caretakers beyond gracious and helpful, and the wine local and flowing, the food, well, it was Italy after all, and we forgot all about our hellish trip up. That is, until we had to make the hellish trip back down. But how else do you get views unless you're up really high? At least that's what we concluded after drinking 40 bottles of wine in a week. We swam in the pool, prepared meals together, and watched the meteor shower blaze across the nighttime sky. We went to big cities and small villages. As we traveled around, we often saw elderly women in cotton dresses pedaling bikes up mountain roads, a sight I have yet to see in this country. We ate out a lot, of course, and sampled the wines, of course. Men were in parks during the day with their children playing chess or bocce ball. Again, not something you see every day in America. I found throughout my travels that people, in certain respects, are very much the same wherever you go, but cultures are very, very different. And that, for me, is the point of travel. Then came the day for us to go to Barga. Now, in Italy, we found that there really is no easy way to get anywhere, particularly if you're in a rural area. So we left in plenty of time and still ended up being late. We had resorted to paper maps since the navigation systems in the other cars had also died. You know, I think this is a trick Italian rental car shops play on all American travelers to get them to buy more wine. And it works, let me tell you. After our third time becoming lost, I just stopped in front of a massive stone wall with a huge gate and turned to my wife. "Do you think we're here?" She looked out the window and said, "Well, considering there's a 12-foot-tall poster of you on the wall over there, I think we found Barga." Then I suddenly noticed that all these cars and policemen directing traffic, and I pulled over to one of them and I asked if he spoke English. He did. I asked him what was going on. He said automatically, "It's David Baldacci Day in Barga. Park over there." I glanced at my wife. She hiked her eyebrows, gave me a scathing look, and said, "David Baldacci Day, are you freaking kidding me?" "I had no idea," I said. "Liar," she shot back. Now, people often ask me why, in all of my books, I only write about strong, independent women. I will reveal the answer tonight. I sleep with one. Apparently, word of our arrival is spread because the mighty Barga gates opened, and out came the mayor, wearing both the Italian and American flags draped around him. Behind him was a marching band. Behind them were journalists and videographers. And behind them, apparently, were all the citizens of Barga. I could also see that American flags were flying over the city. I later learned this had not happened since the end of World War II. The mayor greeted us warmly and then escorted us into the majestic town proper. I have to confess that an image of Dorothy entering the Emerald City did come to mind. Off we went to lunch, marching Pied Piper-like down the narrow, aged streets. And the meal was magnificent, even if I did eat it with 900 new friends. And after we toured the city, visiting the beautiful Duomo and some other sites, I met a little boy who was barely two, who I was told was a Baldacci, and whose parents had traveled from their home in Switzerland to meet me. All in all, there were dozens of family members there, none of whom I'd ever met or even known existed before that day. I did a book signing at the town bookshops, signing both English and Italian versions of my books, and I chuckled when I saw my first novel in Italian. Absolute Power was published in Italy under a pseudonym, because my publisher asked me to change my name because Italians, he said, don't believe that other Italians can write. You know, I pointed out that Machiavelli, Dante, and Puzo had pretty good careers. He went on to elaborate that when it came to thrillers, Italians wanted to read American thriller writers, which they thought were better. When he asked me to come up with a really strong American name, I happened to look out the window of our house and saw the explorer in the driveway, so I suggested the name David Ford. He loved it. Said it sounded very American for some reason. An Absolute Power by David Ford was a number one bestseller in Italy. He's also a very nice man. I know him well. But I've always thought that I was really, really good that I did not own a Lamborghini back then. And then the mayor told me that it was time to give my grand speech in the center courtyard of the city. I was dressed in khaki shorts, polo shirts, and sandals, and I had had like four scoops of gelato. So we trooped to the center of the city. Then the mayor started off the ceremony by bestowing gifts. These included a lifetime supply of olive oil. That was fun getting back on the plane. A genealogical chart of my family dating back to the 13th century, including my grandfather's generation, which I found that he had seven siblings I never even knew he had. They'd never immigrated to the U.S., and that's hanging in my office. T-shirts, an oil painting, and a journal from the town archives that my ancestor Pietro Baldacci had started writing in back in the 16th century. And because paper was so scarce back then, the journal had been handed down to descendants, and the last entry was from the late 1800s. There were gifts also to my wife and our bambinos. As the crowd parted and my daughter walked up to get her goodies, she gave me a look that every father of a teenage girl knows well. You're ruining my life. My son, on the other hand, was blowing kisses the whole way up. There is a difference. And then I gave my speech, necessarily off the cuff, which was translated by two representatives of the city as I gave it. And as I spoke, I realized how truly touched I was by all of this. I'm sure I rambled on, but it was all sincere and heartfelt nonetheless. I do remember saying that even though it was August, it felt more like Christmas in Tuscany. And as I gazed around at all the faces fixed on me, it began to sink in that my grandfather and his father and his father's father and so on had walked these streets, had sat in that Duomo, had married, had children, raised families, and mourned the passing of loved ones. And the cycle had gone on and on and on for centuries. As my speech concluded and I was making my way through the crowd, one of my friends who had traveled there with us directed me to a group of very elderly men. I think the youngest was probably in his early 80s, and the oldest was probably in his early hundreds. And they were sitting on a bench, felt caps on, aged hands clasped around the heads of their old walking canes. And my friend said, these are all Baldaccis. They've all traveled here to meet you. And as one, they all rose, took off their caps, and bowed their heads in respect. And being Italian, we all cried for a very long time. And as I walked back down cobblestone streets, the same surfaces that my grandfather had trod as a young man, I could only marvel at the connection I felt to a place that I had only been in for a few hours. But what a remarkable few hours they had been for me. Of course, not every place that one travels to will conjure these sorts of experiences, but when we do travel to different places and meet different people, regardless of whether we have a connection to that place or not, we do add another chunk of clay to ourselves, which I believe changes in both large and small ways. Although I've not been back to Barga since, I know that I will return there. I have spoken to my late father many times about that place and that trip, and an important part of me believes that he has heard every word. In the meantime, whenever I pick up that old journal and leaf through the pages, I am once more transported back to those cobblestone streets, into that grand city courtyard. In my mind's eye, I look around anew at all these family members who had come to me rather late in my life, yet come they had. And I will never forget them, or that extraordinary day in Barga. Thank you.
Thank you so much, David. I'd like you all to join me in thanking our authors this evening. I've said it before, but I'll say it again. Thank you all. We couldn't have done it without you. We appreciate your generosity. Now I'd like to thank all of you who are staying for a very late dinner to join us in the Great Hall. And for everyone, as you depart this evening, we have a special gift from the Foundation on your way out. Thank you and good night.